I have the privilege of teaching a class that's called Post Foreclosure Eviction Defense. And I teach a clinic that goes along with that class where law students work on live client cases, real people's cases, for credit at the law school. So I'm here to talk a little bit about lawyers working with organizers and how we can work successfully together. I stand on a lot of people's shoulders to do that. My organization, the Legal Services Center, and City Life have been working together for about 35 years or so in a very successful collaboration. So how do lawyers fit into this, I guess? How do we fit into this post-foreclosure eviction movement in Boston? One of the things that we were able to see very early on, and again, our groups have collaborated for many, many, many years. One of the things we saw early on in the crisis was that almost every week in court, there was Deutsche Bank versus Jones and Bank of America versus Smith, and the people weren't coming to court. They were defaulting in the language of court and just not showing up, and you lose by default. What we saw often was a strange phenomenon. You know, Boston has lots of one, two, and many two and three family houses, you know, some owner, sometimes owner occupied, sometimes not. But we'd see a case called in Boston Housing Court that was Deutsche Bank versus John Smith, unit one of this address, Deutsche Bank versus John Smith, unit two of this address, and Deutsche Bank versus John Smith, unit three. Now, John Smith lived in all three units? That's strange. So, you know, these are things, because we're sort of boots on the ground, we like to say, we're in court every week, we're kind of seeing what's going on, and what on earth is this? And we're working with City Life, and we're saying, first of all, you know, we're here and available and hoping and, you know, willing to help folks who are being evicted, but nobody's coming to court, so something's going on out there in the community that's keeping people away from court. And the second thing is, the same people keep getting named over and over. So, very little research led us to see that what banks were doing was were filing a case against the owner of the property, naming him for all three units, so that's the owner of the property, when very easily they could find out that there were three separate tenants in all three of those units. Very, very easily, like maybe looking at the doorbell in the mailbox. wouldn't really take a whole heck of a lot of research. But they were getting away with, in many, many circumstances, getting a judgment order of eviction for the folks in that house. Now, if you didn't know better and a constable showed up at your door and said, you know, you've been evicted by the court, there's been a foreclosure, you know, people were moving out. So it became clear that you gotta get to folks early, and that's one of the important lessons here, right? You gotta get to them early with basic information about what their rights are, because what a lot of lawyers know is it doesn't matter how good the law is, if people don't know about it, and if people aren't empowered to use it themselves, or aren't empowered to at least find out and ask somebody, and if there isn't somebody that they can ask. So the students organized to go out and start knocking on doors and doing the old-fashioned radical organizing model of going out and knocking on doors and giving people basic information. What they would say is, you're gonna hear from somebody from the bank, and they're gonna come and tell you, you know, it's a shame the owner of this house has been foreclosed on, and that's too bad that you have to leave so quickly, but we're the bank with a heart. And so we'd like to offer you $300 as long as you're gone in 10 days. You know, that, and that was very, very, very common. And a lot of people left in 10 days to get the $300 or $400 or whatever it was. Excuse me. So when you get to those folks early and you tell them, well, in Massachusetts, you can only be evicted by a judge. There's got to be a lawsuit. They have to take you to court. They have to win. You have the right to a jury trial. You have the right to have, you know, it's what lawyers would call an equitable argument. If the landlord, if the bank has been a bad landlord, they might not win this case. And in every case, the bank's been a bad landlord. I assume that's nationwide, not just Boston, but the bank has been a horrible landlord. And so you were able to get to folks early. I remember a case of saying to, of talking to a fellow at a Tuesday night City Life meeting, because as was mentioned here, what we do is go to the City Life meetings and make ourselves available so that folks can talk to us about their individual cases. Because folks come there and they get the political organizing, but sometimes they want to talk to somebody about their own case. And we know we can reach a lot of people if we go to City Life on Tuesday night. You're gonna, if you're, the people you want to talk to is a targeted audience, they're coming to City Life, or a lot of the people in the city are coming to City Life, and they can reach out and get some help at the meeting, talk about their individual cases, get advice and counsel, get told about what deadlines are upcoming, get organized around how to answer the complaint in court. We produce, as we have for many years, pro se, meaning unrepresented people's pleadings. So if we find out that somebody's got a case coming up, we send them to a group of students where they are helped to file a response to that eviction proceeding, where they raise all their claims, where they demand a jury trial, and give us a little working room, a little time to, you know, to try to help get them some help. So the mapping and canvassing, you gotta love students for this stuff because they're technical, right? And you gotta law student community around here too, so you know you're lucky to be able to tap into that. Sometimes we talk in communities where they don't have a lot of law students, and I say, okay, you gotta start working on your undergrad students, because the students were able to start mapping where the evictions are happening, and or you know, splitting those up into, you know, either districts or areas or something, working with groups to organize around it. The goal in Boston is to have some students doing the canvassing and have some community members doing the canvassing, because you don't want it to be all students. You want the community out there working also, but there are times when it's good to have some of the students out there. As a result of the early canvassing, all canvassing that happens now, in Boston, it's fair to say that pretty much everybody who's in foreclosure is contacted. That's in foreclosure before they're going to get an eviction case. Everybody gets contacted. And defaults are down to almost nothing. I mean, virtually nothing. Every once in a while, a default comes in. But it's very unusual. Almost every week in court, we know who's coming to court, and we know what their situation is, and we're able to, keep a whole lot of cases afloat at the same time with a relatively small number of lawyers. So I was saying that I talked to a fellow at City Life one night, and I said to him, I was asking him about his individual case, and he told me he had spoken that morning to two students in red shirts, City Life shirts, saying, you know, the two guys in the red shirts, one of them was a football player in undergrad school, so he's a big guy, great big guy, came and talked to me. And he said, you're going to get contacted by a bank, and they're going to say, you know, something to the effect of, you know, we're the bank with the heart, so, you know, we'll give you 20 days to get out, or 10 days to get out, and we'll offer you $300 or something like that. And, well, he said, within 45 minutes, the doorbell rang after those students had left. And there is a representative of the bank who says, well, it's a shame what's happened to you, and we really feel terrible. But we're the bank with the heart, and we'd like to offer you $400. He said, well, you've driven the price of $100. Well, what I can say is after the 4 years that's been going on now, in the last 2 weeks, I can't mention names because the clients aren't allowed to say. So we're getting 10 and 15 and 20 and 30 and $40,000 for individual clients. What does that do? It helps the client a lot. It puts money back into our inner city neighborhoods, large sums of money sometimes, for individual damages claims. What it also does is drive up the price of evicting people. Right? If you're the bank, and we know from inside bank sort of memos and such that Boston is considered ground zero. You don't want to go to Boston. Boston has steam. You don't want to be trying to bring eviction cases in Boston. It's expensive. It's difficult. Those Harvard students will drive you crazy. And it's going to cost you a lot of time and effort and money. And driving, that's the same thing, good old-fashioned radical organizing, drive up the price of what the other side has to do, and you'll slow them down. And you might stop them because eventually the price just gets ridiculous. And at times when at a time like now when the property that the tenant is in is worth less and less and less, if they're going to have to pay more and more and more and more to get the tenant out, it begins to be a waste of time. And we have had many, 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 many cases where the bank just eventually gives up. They just surrender and begin renting to folks or do whatever people are looking for. It's just really a situation where they just say, okay, what do you want? We're like done, you know, what do you want? It's just costing us too much money. The bank wants this over. Part of how you do that for lawyers is with benchmarking cases. I was talking to Matt about this earlier, right? You take some cases that are particularly good cases, and you take them all the way to trial, and you just kind of squash the other side. In our case, it was the Harvard Legal Aid Bureau, which is a student organization at Harvard, took a case of an individual to a jury trial, and the jury gave the fellow $50,000 as damages. In a case that was brought under our consumer protection statute, which means he would have gotten double or treble that amount of money. Massachusetts also, that statute has a fee shifting thing such that if you win, then the bank has to pay the tenant lawyer as well. So now you're looking at, you know, $150,000 in damages, plus whatever you'd have had to pay the lawyers to do, you know, several day jury trial. It's really gonna get obnoxiously expensive for the bank in that circumstance, right? You set a couple of those types of cases, they don't wanna go to the jury. They don't wanna try cases against the jury. It's almost like, you know, what, you know, we have to, everything has to make a deal, and they have to make a deal on everything. If you just make it obnoxiously expensive. And so it seems like you'd have to try every single case, right? Well, no, you just have to try often a few cases to get the to get so that the price, and you have to be willing to take, you know, to take almost every case, or at least take the cases that are coming up for trial. And if you're willing to take those cases, and you get some people, so a relatively small number of people can actually keep, you know, if you set the price that high, it gets very expensive. So we often hear, you get, is there a quote, do you want to wait till the end, or do you want me to?
I want to say something. It's perfect what you said, but there are no lawyers in Baltimore that will take our cases and help us.
Well, we'll talk about how this meeting, I think, is meant to organize people together. One of the things, right, the purpose of this is so that people can, part of the goal, I think, is to have, like, we've had a model that we've been working on in Boston, and working on a long time. This is not going to happen instantaneously. The model we've been working on a long time. And that's something I say to everyone. Everyone says to me, I'm so lucky to work in Boston, where we have all this great law, and we have all these great organizers, and I've just like fallen into this pot of wonderfulness. But you know, 35 years ago, when the predecessors in my group and the predecessors in City Life were starting out, you know, they were facing what everybody's facing before there's an organization of lawyers and organizers in their city. And 35 years from now, we can all be toasting the anniversary of the beginning of the of the process in Baltimore, right? I mean, you know, if you don't start, you don't get there. Another question? Or?
Yes, we should wait. We should take questions at the end.
Okay.
We have another speaker, so.
Sure. It's hard to, when you're a teacher, it's hard to.
I know.
When people are raising their hands.
We are going to have time for questions in there.
Perfect. So the thing about, you know, the other thing I hear is like Massachusetts has great law and we don't have great law. Well, also it's time to start working on that too then, right? Mass, you know, we work with Mass Law Reform, which is a law reform organization, but you gotta get organized around law reform. If you don't like the law you have, you change it. and that's, I'm being, of course, overly ridiculously simplistic, but it's the beginning of the beginning, right? If you want to, if you don't like what you have, if you don't like the consumer law you have, if you don't like the eviction law you have, if you don't like the foreclosure law you have, you start advocating for change. And it's not overnight, it's not instantaneous, but over time, you know, you click away at it, and eventually, like the stone and the river and all that sort of stuff, you get what you need. This is a really, I think, particularly good time, and we've seen it in Boston that it's been a particularly good time to be trying to wear down the rocks. Much of the legislators have seen what's going on in their communities, and they're hearing from their constituents all the time. And everybody's mad at the banks, right? I mean, they've just been ludicrous, they've been ridiculous. There's no excuse for the way they behaved in this market. Robo-signing and backdating assignments and just, you know, just things that are, they can't be serious that they thought anyone would think that this was okay business practice. And so it's a particularly good time, I think, to be trying to work on law reform, right? As if we're ever going to get a legislature who's as mad at the banks as they are now, or who are you ever going to get a time where you're going to get more constituents to call them and complain and try to get your law changed? So I mean, you know, bad times make for, you know, revolt and revolution, and it's a good time for change when people are upset about what's going on, and this is a time when there's a lot of people upset about what's happened. So, you know, think about that in terms of trying to take advantage. City life, the city life model often has been very successful at the steakhouse, which is to have folks like Carolyn go tell their stories to the legislators. Often with, you know, sometimes with, you know, lawyers as backups, because legislators are often lawyers and they have technical questions they want to ask, but they don't want to hear from me. You know, the folks they hear from, they hear very powerful testimony, and it's a game changer a lot of the time. You just can't forget, you know, people saying, I got put out in the street and had to sleep in a car. Or, you know, they don't forget that. They go home and hug their kids and are glad that they have a job and can afford to pay their mortgage, and they're often extremely moved by that, and that has made a lot of changes. Some of the changes in Massachusetts, we were able early to change the statute such that an eviction does not terminate a tenancy. The tenancy is not over when the eviction happens. If you were a tenant before the eviction, you're a tenant after the eviction. I'm sorry, the foreclosure. If you're a tenant before the foreclosure, you're a tenant after the foreclosure. That was a small change in the statute. Actually, I think we changed about 6 words in that statute, but it was a very powerful, powerful change. There were some judges who agreed, as we thought the statute said that beforehand, but there were some judges who didn't, and the legislature was with us on, let's just clear up that question. Why should we have such a question hanging out there? The legislature was willing to make that change. After that, some more very extremely drastic changes have come. In Massachusetts, we were able to get through a statute that says you cannot evict a tenant after foreclosure. A foreclosing entity, like a bank, cannot evict a tenant after foreclosure without due cause, without some kind of cause. So there are 6 enumerated causes in the statute, sorry, I'm talking like a lawyer. There are 6 reasons in the statute why you can evict a tenant. They didn't pay their rent, they violated the law, they violated the lease and the agreement. So there are certain reasons why you can evict a tenant, and other than that, you cannot. So the no-fault eviction that Steve was talking about, like we just want you out, we just want the property empty because we want to sell it empty, like they're selling these things. You know, they're really just throwing everybody on the street and not selling them, right? Boarding up the building. Pretty, right? Pretty. So because of that change in the legislation, it's very, very, it made a very rich environment for tenants. Now, it's a tenant's choice. You can stay, or the bank can buy you out. Having driven up the price of them evicting folks, they realized the price of buying them out was going to be pretty high as well, because we're the same lawyers that were involved in stopping them from evicting folks. We're helping negotiate the buyouts when tenants want to leave. You can help the movement, even if you decide to leave, because driving up the price of them having to buy back the apartment helps the movement. We've also had situations where we've gotten significant damages for folks and long-term leases in response to the fact that the bank has been a very, very bad landlord. We have good landlord tenant law, and I suggest you get some. It's really, really, really helpful in situations like this. So, one of the most important things lawyers can do, besides driving up the price, is to help with the condition of the properties after foreclosure. Most landlords who are going into foreclosure, as they're not paying their mortgage for many, many months, as they're losing money, as they can't afford to do it, let's not be surprised that they're not making any repairs, right? They're not even fixing things that desperately need to be fixed. They may not be paying for service contracts, and properties fall into disrepair. Banks are often shocked when we say at the foreclosure, like when they took over the property, there were significant, you know, conditions of disrepair. They're like, oh, you always say that. Of course we always say that. How many landlords spend a ton of money repairing their property just so it can fall into foreclosure? At the same time they stop paying, they generally stop doing repair work. And so we do find some conditions that have fallen into great disrepair. One of the things lawyers can do is enforce the sanitary code, make the banks make all the repairs. That also drives the price up. The price of owning the property goes up because we're making them do it. And one of my personal favorites, I'm from the inner city of Boston. I grew up in the Dorchester neighborhood of Boston. If any of you know Boston, I see some nods going around. I'm from Dorchester. Is Dilettic. We have anybody that we meet at City Life or anywhere else who has children under six in the property, we're instructing them how to get a free lead inspection from the city. Well, if these banks are going to come into my Dorchester and they're going to take over these properties, while they're taking them over, they're going to delet them because they're the landlord. They're the legal landlord, and if there's lead, they're going to have to remove the lead. So, you know, again, it's kind of making lemonade out of lemons here. If they're going to come in and take my neighborhood, they're at least going to leave it better than they found it. And when they sell that property eventually, hopefully back to the owner, or to the group of the tenants, or to a local nonprofit, like lots of opportunities there, then it's going to be safe. Let's say that, please. All right. One of the most important things about lawyers working with organizations like this is learning your role. And this is really, really, really hard for lawyers. Because our role here is that the law and lawyers are a tool of organizers. Organizers use many, many tools. I just called myself a tool. Lots of cameras rolling too. But yeah, that's what lawyers are. We're a tool of the people here, the tool of the organizers. And lawyers have to be willing, if you're going to work with organizers in this way, there are a million, million, million rewards to doing this. And you really feel like a lawyer many of these days when you're having success in these areas. But you have to know that what your role is to do what is necessary to do. Often, our role is, it's unusual for lawyers to be at a meeting and not asked to speak at all. But at a typical City Life meeting, we might go 8 weeks, 10 weeks, more, where there's no lawyer on the agenda to speak about anything. Because that's not our role there. I mean, the organizers are speaking and the people in the audience are speaking. And we're going to do our job, which is to stay in the back, answer questions if they're asked of us, give advice, be looking out for people who have deadlines, you know, making sure that everybody's case is getting touched and getting moved on to the next the next piece, make sure the pleadings are getting done if they have a court date coming up, making sure they know where they have to be and understand what they have to do. And that's our role, and not to be running the meeting. And that's very foreign sometimes for lawyers, to not be the person running the meeting, not be the person making the decision. But if you were really gonna, for this to really work, for this this type of collaboration to work, and it really, really does work, we have to be able to understand our role. Everyone needs to know what their role is, and lawyers have to be able to say, if asked for my opinion on strategy, I'm glad to give it. You know, kind of like I enjoy strategy, I think it's fun. But if not asked, I'm not going to give it. And and even when I give it, I understand that the decision may very well go another way. What do we do? We also meet up with protests, I hold signs. I sometimes bail people out. And when one meeting, we knew a tide had turned when I was the person in charge, the usual person who bails people out was not available, and it fell to me to be my turn. And after the arrests were made, and I was walking to my car, and I only drove about less than a half a block to find the group of people who had been arrested walking back toward me. Strange. And so I said, "What happened?" And they said, "Oh, they threw us out of the police car." They drove us around the corner after they arrested us and said, "Like, get out. We're not taking you back to the station. Arrest, you know, all the paperwork, all the nonsense, go to court, they're just going to let you go anyway, and we'll probably get a round of applause or something, so, out." Made the bailout do much, much, much easier. But, all right, the role of lawyers, working with organizers, it's very fulfilling. I also feel like with when we're working with law students, the law students are learning how to be good lawyers, they're also learning how to be community lawyers. And they're going places around the country, so it's a wonderful thing to work with students who are as smart as our students are, and who are going places. they're taking this model with them around the world. I mean, certainly around the country and probably around the world, because they're working on this as young lawyers. They're learning social justice is important. Lawyers work on social justice. It's what we do. It's our duty as lawyers to work for social justice, even if that means at 10 o'clock at night at a City Life meeting. That's our role. That's what we do. And it's wonderful to have students involved in such a movement because, like I say, early in their careers, they're, first of all, feeling the fulfillment that you feel.